Hello, Dan Alasso here again with History for Today. I just had a little celebration yesterday that my OER textbook, Modern World History, has just been included in the Open Textbook Library. So now people all over the world can go and take a look at this open resource and use it in any way that they see fit because it has a Creative Commons license on it. As I was working on the version of this that is up on the library now, I was collaborating with another professor in the Minnesota State University system, and he suggested that because not everybody who takes our modern world history courses has taken an ancient world history course, that we should include an introduction that sets the scene a little bit. And so we did that in this one. And one of the main things that it includes is a description of the agricultural revolution. Because obviously it is agriculture and stable food supplies that allow for the growth of civilizations and cities and then city-states and then nations and then empires. So we wanted to describe that for the students so that when we get to the beginning of our text in the 1400s, 1500s, there's some type of a basis for their understanding. So one of the things that fascinates me about the agricultural revolution is the way that our understanding of it has changed over time. Only a generation or two ago, it was believed that the Neolithic revolution or the agricultural revolution happened only in the Fertile Crescent from Mesopotamia through the eastern shore of the Mediterranean, what's now Palestine, and into Egypt. And that the central and most important contribution of these people who supposedly invented agriculture was the domestication of wheat. Subsequently, of course, and to some extent contemporaneously, people understood that rice cultivation had also begun somewhere between 10,000 and 7,000 years ago in the Pearl River estuary in what's now China. And then, of course, later we had to admit that the domestication of maize or corn from Teosinte, the native grass of Mesoamerica, also happened at about that time, between about 10,000 and 7,000 years ago. And similarly, the domestication of what became the potato in the Altiplano, the high plateau of the Andes Mountains in South America, also happened about that time, as also did the domestication of cassava and its processing into manioc or tapioca. And of course, those five staple crops are the world's most important staple crops today. Corn, wheat, rice, potato, and manioc are the top five staple foods in the world today. And so for a long time, historians wondered how it was that this concurrent development actually happened. And so many oftentimes very convoluted explanations arose for why it was that people in different parts of the world seemed to have had the same insight at about the same time. And there were actually, in a lot of cases, some supernatural and metaphysical explanations for this. And then other scientists began thinking, well, maybe it's really not that mystical and mysterious. Maybe the techniques that led to agriculture were much older and go back much deeper into our prehistory than we had previously imagined. Now, interestingly, before I even became a historian, I had read a very little book by a British science writer who tends to write on genetics and evolutionary topics named Colin Tudge, called Neanderthals, Bandits, and Farmers. And obviously, I read it because the title just fascinated me. And it was very interesting because in addition to saying some controversial things about Neanderthals and the early prehistoric development of civilization, Tudge also suggested that what we now think of as agriculture began with what he called horticulture, with a much older process of people beginning to understand more than 10,000 years ago and probably closer to 20,000 years ago, people beginning to understand plants. And obviously this is a knowledge that it is easy for us to discount nowadays and not even notice, but people in the ancient world knew what they could eat and what they couldn't eat. How did they come by this knowledge? How did they pass this knowledge along before the age of writing and written documents? The development of this knowledge, Tudge said, is very, very ancient. and proceeded from knowing which plants you could eat and which plants you should avoid to beginning to treat the plants that were bearing fruit or that would bear tubers or that had some type of medicinal value, treating them more carefully and maybe even weeding around them so that your access to them would be unobstructed and they would grow better. And then, of course, at some point, somebody discovered that the seeds of plants that were dropped by camp sprouted into those same types of plants, right? And that may have led to people beginning to plant things close to camp so that they wouldn't have to go wandering around the countryside and expend a lot of time and energy finding the things that they needed. So the idea that this all happened in the ancient past, tens of thousands of years ago, then makes it possible to imagine that the Homo sapiens who came out of Africa and probably lived close together, or at least in contact for a time, may have developed this knowledge before they began to separate, and before some of them went to what became Europe, some of them went to what became Asia, others went to the northern part of Asia and lived in Beringia during the Ice Age, and then, of course, found their way to the Americas. So this is all a much more plausible explanation, in my mind, than the idea that there was some type of coincidence of concurrent development of agricultural techniques all over the world, just about simultaneously, beginning around 10,000 years ago. So the point for my students, of course, will be that agriculture and food surpluses lead to the need to store food and then also lead to the possibility for divisions of labor between the people who produce food and other people who do other things. And that is the beginning of what we call civilization. It's also, of course, the beginning of conflict, because once you have possessions and you're no longer moving around following the food that is in season or the animals that you hunt that are migrating, then you have possessions. And then some people have more possessions than others, and you begin to have haves and have-nots. And many of the problems of civilization tend to arise from those divisions. So it's definitely a mixed blessing. And although it's an example from the ancient world, this is, I guess, an example of some of the insights that I want my students to begin trying to develop about the things that they learn about the past. So I hope this has been interesting. Stay tuned for more. I'll see you again next time.